First of all, I want to thank all of you all that in spite of your hectic schedules, you are still making it. Okay. And today's speaker is, I met sir at IIM, there he is.
Hi, hi, how are you?
Fine, sir. Right. So I met Kitesh sir at IIM Bangalore when I had gone to do a program on digital marketing. So I know I'm a finance person, but I just went because I wanted to know what is this all about. Did I get a lot of inputs? Yes, maybe 50-60%. I could understand that the world is changing. So they were talking about a lot of things, a lot of jargons. I made my notes. Very interesting to learn new things. So there were two faculties I was very impressed with. One is Hitesh sir, who came and he rocked. I don't want to comment on other faculties, but two very much improved. One is Hitesh sir, and there was one more colleague who is now working for Google in India. These were two people I really liked. And then I kept in touch with Hitesh ji, and and I realized he's a very kind-hearted person, right? He takes a lot of sessions, right? He has now guided a lot of teachers on pro bono basis. And Hitesh ji's own line is, for teachers, I will not charge anything because they are building the nation. So, Hitesh ji's profile is, he's a digital market expert and international speaker. Over a decade of experience in digital, digital technologies, digital marketing, social media, public relations, right? Prior to his current role, he was working with Ogilvy and Mattup. That's very good. And some of his clients were Nakheel, Twitter, Chartered Financial Accounting, Exim Bank, Future Generali, Life Insurance, and Bandhan Bank. He was also the head of PR and marketing for Crompton Greaves. And he has led the account for the Tata Group, when Sir was with Rediffusion Y&R. Now, some of these terms, I may be pronouncing it wrongly. I'm very sorry. But all I can say is a wonderful human being. He's ever ready to help colleagues. So I got in touch with Sir. So I have seen him speak. Unlike some speakers where I admit I have not heard them speak, I've seen him speak. He'll simply rock. First is my brother's disclaimer clause, right? I think it helps. Somewhere it will help me, I'm sure. So yes, thank you, Ganeshji, for sending this disclaimer clause. Thank you, Dr. Srikanth. Thank you very much, sir. Right, you are with us in spirit and guide. I hope you have realized, all of you all, that Telegram, I realized that, you all are all guiding each other impromptu. Like Chaitanya is very active there. Saurabh is very active there. So it's so good to see you all are helping each other, which is exactly what we should do in these challenging times. Parimal Machan sir has come and spoken, so I don't need to tell you about Parimal Machan sir. He's a rock star, right? Always a pleasure to work under such people. And all these colleagues, Shanti ma'am, right? Suresh ji, right? I should really thank Arpit and Rahul ji, who ensured that we keep uploading everything on YouTube, Men and Mantras. Some videos have again gone private, one of them, which is on request of the speaker, which is perfectly fine. And today's knowledge partner is Mr. Hitesh Motwani. I call him New Gen Digital Marketing Guru. It is new gen, because there's something which I have not learned when I was in Bajaj, and he's absolutely amazing. I still remember after Sir's class, one colleague was speaking among us, 15 of us. He said, "Ye class se paisa vasool hua." Thank you, all of you all. You all rock. So we are keeping on moving. I have decided I'll not stop, right? Till the last, I will keep going like this. So we are doing pretty well now. Even now, 200 rupees, 10,000 is coming. Of course, it is slowing down. Don't go with the numbers, what is shown by the government. Go with your company's targets. I can tell you with confidence, the companies that I am associated with, we are doing okay. Thank you again. This is all of you all, the sponsors. Thank you, all of you all. I will not take much time in this, right? Gani is already there. Saurav Agarwal is also, I'm sure, would have joined by now. Akshay Kalyanpur is also doing well. He's doing a virtual exhibition now. Now, Akshay Kalyanpur is doing a virtual exhibition this week. Okay, so I'm telling you, right, kids are rocking. Pai just named his kid, right? Ronit is the name of his kid. So Rahul just told me that today, I've named my kid yesterday. He gave me the news. Ronit is the name of the kid. So there's progress, progress in business, progress in personal life. Yes, Integrated Group, just met them. God bless, right? Yogesh Group is also doing well. They're coming up with a school. Jayasha sir is doing extremely well, virtual accountant. Right. Saili, I'm sure, is doing well. I'd like to get in touch with her again. right? Yes, Meba doing pretty well. Shah family, I have not visited them. Prasad, I'm visiting. I'm going to Pune on the 8th. I'll be going and meeting them. Simar is doing very well. He's looking for independent directors. Anjayji, what do I say? He's helping every single individual on the group recover their money. Sunanda, I think I'm connecting it to Nisha Manjrekar, ma'am. I'm not getting it. Ma'am is not responding. But I suspect that is Nisha Manjrekar, ma'am has got something to do with Sunanda, if I'm not wrong. But anyway, Mahavir, Manoj More, he came specifically for Parimal sir's lecture. And, you know, I think big fan of Parimal sir. Pratik, God bless. George sir, right? What do I say? Festivals, Viral is rocking. Right? Hiten, right? Krishna group. This is the Vardhaman group. This is wonderful, wonderful. Satwa Logistics, right? I'm showing it separately. All of you all know why, right? Contribution of 70,000 is something which unheard of, at least for me. Okay, yes. Today is the final time I will be showing this. Three times I've shown it. I hope Shrikunj has joined. Thank you, Shrikunj Bete. Every part of your sale you're donating, I think the least I can do is show your sponsorship three times. Thank you very much. The entire family is right there. Shrikunj has very deliberately not put his photograph. God bless him. That's his logo. I'm hoping that he has got in touch with Gani, and Gani said yes. So I hope that entire thing will shift to exports. I believe we should look at exports in a big way. Krishna Rana is looking at exports in a big way. Earlier, 100% was domestic clients. Now, 80% is domestic clients. 20% is exports. Krishna Rana, Platinum Industries. You want examples? I'll give it to you all. Okay, right. 20% exports already. Qatar, Saudi Arabia cracked. Sri Lanka cracked. Now going to Africa. Okay. Krishna Rana, the sponsor of our Zoom license. Okay. Platinum. Thank you. Thank you, Shrikunj. These are his products. Anybody wants to get in touch, please, please do so. Here is it. Every single thing under the garments is being offered. Home textiles. These are the markets, international markets. Shrikunj's dream is to have an office in US. I think if he can get in touch with Gani, which I've requested, that dream also will be fulfilled, because Gani is always eager to help entrepreneurs, right? And Gani has come up the hard way. So I don't know if Shrikunj is there. If he's there, please get in touch with Gani. I make an appeal for the last time. Anga Collective, Kitesh sir, this is for you. We have now moved to 1 lakh people, sir, all over India. So this entire life has changed in the last 70 days for me personally. Very fulfilling, which I told you, sir. It's because of this Hunger Collective, not in terms of money, but definitely in terms of satisfaction. So I've realized I've reached the top of Maslow's pyramid now. Okay, so very, very well. And the best part is we have reached Assam also. Thanks to these two ladies, Rajshree Sai and Ashlesha Matre, we have reached Assam also. Very happy. Now we are again trying to loop it and take select one place and then again start Hunger Collective, and things will move. Okay. So today, this is for all those people. The act of Visarjan teaches you to let go of something you love deeply. That means if you love something, let go. Don't get attached. This is what is the entire essence of Visarjan. I stop my share. I hand it over to our speaker. And you can trust me, all of you all, you're going to have the time of your life. It is new gen marketing. I swear, because right, I know Hitesh sir. I personally experienced the magic. I now withdraw, giving a namaste to sir. I salute the divinity in you, sir, please.
Thank you so much, Anil sir. You know, like, it's very enlightening to see, because I've never seen such an intro. I've attended like over 100 webinars till date, right? But it's very kind of you, you know. So first of all, thank you everybody for joining in. It really means a lot that people coming from different parts of India, and somebody from internationally as well, are you over here. So I want to just say that for the next 1 hour, I want you to take a notepad and a pen. And I wanted to basically note down all of these things, because what I'm going to share with you today, okay, probably even if you implement just two things out of that, trust me, your life will basically change after this. And that's my personal guarantee, because we're doing the same session, okay, with family business owners approximately, you know, just a couple of months back for SP Gen. And that really, you know, got us extremely good feedback. And post this, you know, the session is specially curated for people who are looking to generate leads from different sorts of arenas. So today what I'm going to do is I'm going to share with you a framework which is going to help you to generate leads, to understand digital better, and most importantly, to implement digital better. All right. So let me just quickly share my screen with all of you. And I hope you can see my screen. So let me just give you like a very quick introduction about me. Okay, so just to kind of set the context, and to also to kind of tell you that, you know, in my life, I've handled multiple businesses. You know, in fact, So I've been working with a company called Ogilvy O&M, which is a very big ad agency in the world, one of the biggest ad agencies. If you've seen Ab Ki Baar Modi Sarkar campaign, if you've seen Ramesh Suresh campaign, they are handled by this company. I didn't handle them personally, to be very frank. But I launched Twitter in India. That's my success story. I worked with Twitter. I currently start up, I currently mentor on behalf of Facebook. In the past, I've handled clients like Mr. Ratan Tata, and I did his digital marketing as well. And also, today I'm also a professional trainer. So this is my bread and butter. This is what I do full time. And also, I do consulting as well. So we're consulting brands like Mahindra, Aaj Tak, a lot of other big companies right now. Today, essentially, we've trained over 20,000 plus people pre-COVID, and during COVID, we trained about 1 lakh people so far, right? Including teachers, students, and everybody else as well. So we trained over 20,000 plus participants, and over 400 plus corporates till date. Not only that, we've helped the following firms like Landmark, Ogilvy, McDonald's, LG. So you name the company, we've trained them in the past. And I'm also an IIM faculty. I'm a non-IIM, non-IIT, by the way. I don't have any background from any fancy schools. I come from a very humble background. In fact, I'm just a plain BCom student. But I'm happy to say that today I'm teaching some of the best institutes. And also because of Anil sir's blessing, I got introduced to SPGen and Princeton, a lot of other places as well, which has basically helped me, to get my footholding in the market. And we do a lot of workshops, not only in India, but India, Singapore, and Dubai as well. And also, as I told you, I'm a mentor on Facebook. So today we're living in a very interesting time. You know why? Because today's time, babies are born with internet. Babies do not know how to speak, but they know how to operate a remote control and the phone. And that's where digital world is, at its brim right now. In fact, today is the time where machines are learning and human beings are hooked onto their cell phones. That's the kind of state that we're living in right now. Not only that, today, in fact, if you ask me, doing business is much, much easier than before. You know why? Because today's technology eliminates the problem of finding people. Just to give you some research over here, the number of people today who have started entrepreneurship is 10 times higher than 10 years back. You know why? Because 10 years back, one of the most difficult things on this planet was to find customers. If you remember the good old days of door-to-door selling. But today, with the power of my laptop, I can sit anywhere, open my laptop, run my campaigns, and I can target people anywhere in the world. So whether you're doing exports, whether you want to expand to international market, like I heard Anil sir saying that somebody wants to expand in the US market, it is possible today, sitting in India and reaching out to people across the world. In fact, you all have power where customers search for you rather than you searching for customers. And in fact, sitting at your home, you can meet customers and prospects virtually as well. If you see people in 2000, when they used to go out there, they used to only look at, concert. But today, people in 2020, every single person today is using their cell phone to kind of see things, right? And people, especially in quarantine, are now spending four times more time on social media as compared to anything else. So the question is, the world is changing, but the question is, are you? So if you really ask me, I divide the world into two parts. I normally call this life before mobile and life after mobile, right? So in case you relate to any of these things, I want you to keep on typing on the chat box, I do. If you see earlier, we used to watch TV on television set. But today we watch the entire TV, okay, on Netflix, right? Or YouTube. That's become a second source for television, right? In fact, if you have two TV in your home, I can bet you that only one TV has a connection of DTH. The second TV purely works on a Chromecast or an Amazon Fire Stick, or you just use it for watching Netflix. Not only that, if you notice earlier, we used to wait for 1 week, okay, to basically come for a new episode. But today, what we do is we binge watch the entire season in one single night. In fact, earlier we used to remember people's phone number, but today we don't even remember our own phone numbers. In fact, today we are more comfortable chatting than speaking. Today the way we read books have changed. In fact, we listen to books. The way we listen to songs have changed. We stream songs. And the way we actually, book our tickets have also changed. The way we do banking has changed. And even the education industry is moving online. So the question is, why not you? So in case you relate to all of these things, I want to keep on the chat box, I do, right? In fact, if you really ask me, we all currently are only in one business, and that business is marketing ourselves. Because if you don't market yourself, somebody else will market as a treasure of products, and they will go and serve more customers than you. So remember something, if the best product in the market does not win, it is the best known product in the market that always wins. Is Starbucks the best coffee in the world? Not really. But is Starbucks the best known coffee in the world? Definitely yes. Which is why, in case if you're keen, right, you should become the best known. Because the more known you are, the more customers you'll get. That is where this thing known as word of mouth works beautifully, very well. Because ultimately, you're getting known to many people by somebody else. But today, you can amplify this further using digital. So I want a commitment from all of you. I want all the people today over here, telling me that from today onwards, you'll not try to become the best. You'll actually try to become what we call as the best known. Type the word BK on the chat box in case they're committed to become the best known rather than just being the best, right? That's really the thing. So, if you really ask me, when you wake up in the morning, maximum people before they go to sleep in the night and before they wake up in the morning, they only go for one thing, which is cell phones, right? In fact, there are more phones in the world than toothbrushes in the world. There are about 7 billion people on this planet, out of which 5.1 billion people own a cell phone, only 4.2 billion people own a toothbrush. The largest country in the world is no longer India, China, or US. It's Facebook, with about 2.3 billion people currently who are online. And not only that, today digital marketing is more like oxygen for small businesses. Because at least big businesses can spend money on TV, print, radio. But small businesses, unfortunately, can do nothing apart from digital. Because digital is the only medium that we can reach out to maximum people, in today's time. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you an action plan today. I'm going to give you a four-step strategy. If you are able to do this four steps with me, I guarantee you will basically get a lot to take away home. So are you ready for this four steps? Give me a quick ready in the chat box if you're ready for this, right? And I'm going to lay down all these four steps for you right now. Okay. So the first step is what we call is you need to find what's your whom. Okay. Finding your whom is the most important. What do I mean by this? For example, whenever I ask people who's a customer, they say, everyone, whoever has money is my customer. That's not the case. It's not everyone. It's a specific person who's your customer. So you need to make what we call a buyer persona. For this, I've got a formula for you. This formula is called CDSPP. And I want you to write this, and I want you to write down on a piece of paper, because when you write this down, you get immense clarity on who should you reach out to, where should you reach out to, how should you reach out to. So the first thing you should be doing is write down over there who is your customer. So you're going to say, my customer is Dash. For example, your customer is what? He's a freelancer. He's an importer. He's basically a woman entrepreneur. He's a working professional working in technology companies. Who is your customer? Write that down. Who they are, what they do. So their age group, their working style, what they do. Second thing is write down the designations in the company. Now, why this is important is because with digital mediums today, we can target people no matter wherever they are. So what's the designation of this guy? Is he basically a CEO of a company? Is he a CMO of a company? Is he basically a purchase manager? Is he an admin manager? So whatever people you've dealt with, and if you know the designations, write them down. Is he owner, proprietor, CEO, founder, managing director, chairman? Whatever it is, just write that down. Third thing is, what is the sector he's working in? Because based on sectors, today with using Facebook and LinkedIn, I can target people and I can show them that, hey, you know what? I want to reach out to you and basically, this is my product, this is my services. Are you interested in buying them? Correct? As simple as that. So what sector they work in? So CDS, customer, designation, and sector. These three things will actually help you to pinpoint who your customer is. Do you currently find this extremely valuable, this current framework? Right? CDS, give me a quick yes in the chat box. I think this one is extremely valuable, right? So this is the first thing you should be doing is writing down, okay, who is your customer, what's his designation, and which sector does he work in? Now, after you've done that, I've seen many people, when they start putting content out, okay, on the chat box, right? So when they start putting content out on Facebook, social media, or through their WhatsApp flyers to their customers, usually they write about the product. They say, buy my product, buy my PVC sheets, buy my accounting services, buy my solar panels. That's what everybody does, correct? But, if you do that, trust me, nobody's going to buy from you. You know why? Because nobody likes to be sold, but people like to buy. Okay, and that is basically the thing. Okay, thing is that nobody likes to be sold, right? So you shouldn't sell your products. Today, people do not buy product. Today, people buy what we call as results. So suppose I'll give you an example over here. Let's say that there are two people, there are two weight loss consultants. The first weight loss consultant says that you know what? I'm gonna help you lose weight in 6 months. Okay, you wanna know how? Come to me. Second one says, you know what? I'm going to help you to fit back in your old clothes. I'm going to help you to, you know, build your stamina. I'm also going to help you so that, you know, more people start calling you smart. If you want to get any of these things, come to my office and I'm going to show you how to lose weight. Which one do you think is better? The first one who just says, come to me, I'm going to help you lose weight, come to me. Or second one who says, I'm going to help you fit back in your old clothes, come to me. Which one is better? The first one or second one? Second one, obviously, right? Why second one better? You know why? Because he doesn't sell the product. He is currently solving the opposite person's problem. So the second PP over here is what we call his pain to pleasure journey. So first things first, write down what is the pain point of your customer. For example, his pain point is that, you know, he wants a good investment plan. His pain point is he lost money in stock markets. His pain point is that, you know, he's unable to manage his finances. How can you solve them? You can solve them by giving better financial planning, by giving him products that is just going to multiply his money, by giving him stability in this current volatile market, right? That's what it is. So when you write this framework down, it's going to help you to get your products and services to a better state, right? So as simple as this, you know, for example, I'll give you about my business. So who's my customer? My customers are HNI, students, freshers, entrepreneurs, right? Because ultimate digital marketing is a meet for everybody, everyone of these currently. Who's the designation? My designation is a CEO, CMO, and purchase manager. Because they are, you know, they are my people. If I go to a corporate, do a corporate training, these are three people I want to talk to, right? Number three, what sector they work in? They might be working in automobile, chemicals, FMCG, digital marketing, in these sectors. What are the pain points? The pain points are, you know, they don't know how to find leads. They do not know how to close deals. They don't know how to run campaigns, right? They're spending money, but they don't get results. Now I'm going to help them. What's a pleasure? I can solve problem by doing digital consulting. I can give them a digital marketing action plan. I can basically help them run their campaigns, and I can train them and train their organizations and helping them to grow their business. So, did you find this framework to be extremely effective? And do you think this was really valuable for you? Right? If you're clear about this, give me a quick clear on the chat box. You're very, very clear about this so far. Right? So, this is the first thing you should be doing for your business. Right? Great. The second step. Let's go to the second step right now. Second step is to create a professional brand. Now, when you're doing digital marketing, remember three things. Number one, your digital marketing should solve people's problem. That's the first thing, right? So when you start putting any content out, it should be problem solving in nature. Number two, you should have a system in place. Get a process in place. Automate the mundane tasks which you have. For example, sending an email, sending SMSs, sending WhatsApp to people. You know, there are a lot of automation tools that do what's to basically automate them. And third thing is give proof to people. For example, you know, try to get as many testimonials as you can to basically to build that credibility in front of people that whomever you're speaking to for any product or services, that's going to be working for them. Now, I'm going to show you something very practically. Okay, so there are three main things you should be doing. Number one, you should be doing what we call as social media, right? So there are three S's you should be taking care of. Today, in digital world, the customer can only find you with three S. One is social media. Second is search. Third is what we call is shopping, right? Social media is what? Which platform should you go to? Now, sometimes, you know, people make accounts on all the possible platforms. And then they feel, you know what? I should be putting out content. I should be doing marketing on all these platforms. Not really. I'm going to show you a power of social media. How many of you guys over here want to see the real power of social media? And you want to see back end of mine? Give me a quick show me on the chat box. And I'm going to show you exactly, okay, which is going to be extremely mind-blowing for all of you. So I'm going to take you to one of my backend. Okay, so I'll just give you a quick perspective. This is my backend Facebook dashboard, right? And we can do the same thing on LinkedIn. We can do the same thing on Google as well, but you know, I'm not restricted to Facebook and Instagram as of now because that's one of the best mediums. Now suppose somebody is B2B, you may be wondering, is Facebook or Instagram relevant to me? Well, remember something, in digital world, it's not about B2B or B2C. It's about H to H. It's about human to human. Remember something, the opposite person on the opposite side is also a human. He doesn't differentiate with himself with a B2B or a B2C, correct? So remember that. Okay, so now let me kind of show you the magic of this, okay? So let me give you some, first of all, let me give you some social proof. Since I have, you know, told you right now, social proof is very important. As you can see currently, on my own personal branding in my company, I spent close to almost 10 lakh rupees. You see over here? Yeah. This is a figure in front of you live. You know, I can Photoshop and I can fudge this currently. Now, let me show you the magic of running campaigns. So today, you know, maximum people do this thing called as boost post when they come on Facebook. You shouldn't do that. That's a pure waste of money. right? So if you really want to generate leads, you should be doing one campaign. This is called lead generation out here, or a traffic campaign. Now, remember I gave you the framework earlier, CDS, PP. The reason I gave you that is because we can start plugging those people in to our social media right now. And we can start targeting people whomever we want and wherever we want. I'm just going to give you a small glimpse of this in this session right now to just show you how powerful social media can become. Okay, so look at this. So for example, you know, it is still loading currently. Let me just try to change. Let me just refresh this page. So yeah, so what I was telling you is, you know, to the three things that really happens over here. Number one, I can target my customers based on a designation. So today on Facebook, if I target any CEO of a company, any CMO of a company, any chief accountant of a company, any export manager, purchase manager, shopping manager, I can basically do that, right? I can do all of these things on this platform. Not only that, suppose I want to target people, you know, currently with as vague as people currently in relationship, or you know, people currently who are interested in magic breaks, or I can also make competition over here as well. So I hope now my connection will work properly. So I just come to create again. So you come to Facebook ads, you come to create. Let me just quickly do a traffic, right? So what typically happens is, you know, I can come down to this particular page over here called ad set, and then I can target people wherever I want. So let's take, for instance, I want people in India. So you can see right hand side, the figures over here shows 340 million people currently in India right now, right? But let's take, I don't want that. Let's take, I want people in Cochin, okay? So I can then target any people in Kochi currently, and I can see how many people are there in Kochi. There's about 26 lakh people currently in Kochi right now. Again, target people in Mumbai. So I can target people wherever they are, Mumbai, Delhi, Bangalore, Kochi, whichever part of country they are. For example, I can also target specific pin code. Let's take, target people in Bandra only. I can type the pin code called Bandra, and then I can only target people currently staying in Bandra. About 1.5 lakh people are there in Bandra right now. Okay, I can target. Then I can come down over here and I can say, okay, my age group of my people is, let's take my people are between 25, 26 to say, for example, about 40, right? So I can then showcase my ad to only people in Bandra who are 25 to 40, and there's 16,000 people currently over here. Not only this, I can target any female, male or females. Then I can also target people currently owning an iPhone, right? And people who only are interested in iPhone will see my ads. People who are only CEOs of companies will see my ads. People who are only CMO of companies will see my ad. People who are currently, let's take for example, people who are currently single, okay? I can show them my ad. People who are currently married, I can show them my ads. So you can think of it and you can target those people out here. Let's take for example, I'm going to target people who just got babies in the last 12 months. I can type over here, new parents, and then I can show my ads to people who just got babies in the last 12 months, right? And I can show my ads to every single person. And you can see over here in Bandra, there are about 20,000 people currently who fall under these three categories over here. And that's the power of digital. You know, I can show my campaigns to those people who really matter to me, right? And this is, now, the question is, how do you target people? Follow the framework. Who is your customer? What's the designation? What sector he works in? For example, if your customer is in automobile sector, type the word automobile out here, correct? And you can target, and you can target everybody, you know, who basically is interested in automobiles, or automotive industry. So we can simply do that and we can go to anybody whom we want. I hope you understood the power of social media now, right? So currently, I mean, I'll give you my own example right now. So currently, you know, like I'm running an ad campaign for corporate trainings. So, I mean, that's a pure B2B business, okay? Like, and you know, so currently I just ran an ad today afternoon. And if you see over here, all the ads are in review right now, correct? Because Facebook really checks them before they go live. So I'm running the ads not only in India, I'm also running the ads currently in, you know, in US, Singapore, Malaysia, and multiple other countries from here as well. So whatever I'm telling you, I actually practically do it myself. And you can see over here, you know, we're targeting people who are director of HR, CHRO, you know, public relations, sales and marketing, training, founder, CEOs of companies, learning development managers, marketing managers, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? And then at the last stage, you basically put your creatives, you put your ad copy, and you just show them the ads. So currently, if you see over here, this is my credentials, which I normally put over here, and I'm running the ad to all of these people specifically, telling them if they're interested in, you know, in their increasing their business, increasing their sales, you should come to us, and we can help their companies, you can help their teams from that. So we're doing that currently. If you see, you know, my company is now running an ad campaign in Dubai. And sitting in India, we're currently tapping the customers in Dubai right now. In this lockdown, you'll be surprised people actually doing that. And look at this, right? This is currently, we're running the ads of Dubai webinar right now. and look at the lead cost. Lead cost means people who give me their details, people who give me their name, email, and phone numbers. And look at the cost. It's only 25 rupees per lead. Now, even if you do an exhibition, you can't get such a low lead cost anywhere, correct? And you know, this is a campaign for one of our full programs which we do. You can see the lead cost over here, 19 rupees, 26 rupees, 21 rupees. That's how cheap marketing is. So a lot of people feel marketing is expensive. Oh, you know, do I have to really spend a lot of money? Not really, you know. You don't have to spend a lot of money. You can see over here, currently, you know, we're hardly spending 1,000 rupees, 2,000 rupees so far. And we're running campaigns only for 100, 200 rupees per day. And we're still able to generate a lot of leads and get customers. Yes, I mean, you know, we're running about 10, 20 campaigns. So we're spending close to 4,000-5,000 rupees per day right now. We're testing campaigns right now. And once this works pretty well, then we can start doing that. So how many of you guys over here, you know, you basically thought, you never imagined that digital can be this powerful, correct? And you can actually specifically reach out to people, no matter whichever industry they are in, B2B or B2C. In case you found this to be super amazing, type the word wow on chat box in case you found this to be extremely, extremely useful for all of you, right? So this is the first thing you should be doing, okay? You should be doing social media campaigns, social media ads. It's the most important thing. Now, second thing is what we call is SEO and SEM. What's SEO? So I'll just give you like a perspective on SEO. So today, let's take for instance that I go to Google right now and I type over here PVC sheet manufacturers, okay? And as you can see, you know, there's some things, sometimes ads comes up on top and sometimes you see results over here are coming for free, some free results. The result that come on Google for free is called SEO, search engine optimization. But the question is, how do you come up on top? And what is the science behind you ranking on top for your websites on Google searches? Well, it's quite easy, actually. You know, so let's take this Parshva Polymer. Parshva Polymer is currently coming up on top. But the question is, why is Parshva Polymer coming up on top? They're purely coming up on top because, you know, they have put what we call as a keyword. What's the keyword that people type on Google in their website? So a lot of time what happens is we just try to make the website look very fancy. It's not about the website being fancy. It's about what content you put which is relevant to user. For example, you know, I put this keyword over here, PVC sheet exporter from Mumbai and PVC products in this title. The same keyword is put over here also, a leading exporter of the PVC sheets. The same keyword is repeated this word PVC sheets approximately, you know, 10 times on the entire website. That's what Google understands, that this guy is currently exporting PVC sheets from Mumbai to the world, correct? So this is what we call this keywords. Even if I type the exact same thing, suppose I type over here PVC sheets exporter from Mumbai and I press enter, I can bet you on this, the same website will start coming up on top. Why? Because they're trying to optimize this particular keyword. You see, Parshva Polymer, PVC exporter from Mumbai. And they're, I mean, this guy, PVC manufacturer, supplier, exporters, dealers in India, maharashtra.com. This is what we call as keyword optimization. You have to put the keyword in strategic places on our site. Now you'll see, this is pretty easy. What if I repeat keyword 100 times? Then what will happen? If you do it more than what's required, Google will spam you. And you can't do that. So the rule is, in every 100 words that you write on your website, you cannot repeat the keyword more than 10 times. Sorry, more than one time. In every 100 words, only one time. Suppose if you've got 1,000 word article on your website, you cannot repeat the keyword more than 10 times. If you over-repeat them, Google will consider to be spamming and they won't allow you. Right? And there are more factors such as your website should be good quality, it should load pretty fast, it should work on mobile phone, tablet, computer, and multiple other places as well. So if you come on top, you know, you get free businesses. So like, let's take for example today, if I type something like, say, you know, digital marketing expert and press enter, right? You can see over here, okay. You see over here, my name is coming Google searches on top. It's called local SEO. That means, you know, people in and around the area, local businesses, you can start coming up on top. So people are shop owners out here, people who are like, you know, who's got jewelry shops, who've got some showrooms. You should be listing yourself on Google local business. It's again absolutely free. You can go to this site called Google My Business, follow the instruction from here, and start listing your business on top on Google searches. Okay. So it can again help you to, you know, to do something better and ultimately start ranking on top as well. So you can do this. Okay, it's called SEO, search engine optimization. The last thing that we call is SEM, search engine marketing, which is running ads. For example, like this, what called CRM software. If I'm a software manufacturer, I can start running ads in on top as well. You can see over here, Active Campaign, Zendesk, Webzino, Freshworks, etc., etc. These are like, you know, running ad campaigns out here. So you can start running ad campaigns for yourself, and you can simply, you know, start ranking on top of Google searches. This is this tool. So this is what we call is, you know, search engine marketing. So the three things you should do: social media, SEO, and SEM. Now, SEM is where you can put a bunch of keywords at the back end of Google. You can ask Google to, hey, you know what, rank me on top for this particular word, and I'm ready to pay for it. So you have to pay some money for this to come up on top, which is normally we call this cost per click. It means you have to pay for every single rupee that you spend, every single rupee. So you don't get charged when somebody sees your ad. You only get charged when somebody clicks on the ad. So when somebody clicks, they come to your site, they fill up a form, you have to pay for it. As simple as that. Right. This is what we call is, you know, creating a professional brand. So you should do three things, three S's: social media, SEO, SEM. Are we clear with this so far? Give me a quick clear on chat box. I think they're very clear with this, and you got it. I know it's a bit fast. It might be a lot of time to take, but you know, unfortunately, I got through the entire digital over here. But I'm trying my best to give you the crux of all of these mediums, right? The third thing you should be doing is what we call is creating a funnel. Now, what's a funnel? Let me explain this to you. You know, when you go to a restaurant, and when you basically eat a food, can you tell me a restaurant owner's the profit that they make is in what product? In which product do they make the maximum profit? Is it the bhaji that they serve you? Is it, or is it something else? Where do they make the maximum money when they serve you food? Put some answers in chat box. Is it desserts? Water is free, I guess. Coke, well, that's MRP, right? Combo, correct? Combo is one thing, yes. Drinks, yes. Something more, but suppose when you're eating a lunch or dinner, what item is the most profitable for a restaurant in your thali? Papad, okay. Just because I'm a Sindhi, right? Just kidding. Okay. It's actually chapati, the roti. If you see roti anywhere, okay, it's about 10 to 25 rupees. If you take a naan, it's about 45 bucks. If you take a roti, it's about 20 rupees per roti, right? Tandoori roti, especially. Now, if you really ask me, one can share a bhaji, but one can't share a roti. Correct. And roti, people will eat roti because, you know, that's what they want to call maximum. If you notice, when you go to a restaurant, your maximum bill is not for a chapati or a bhaji. Sorry, it's not for bhaji or any other things. It's because of rotis. Everybody at least have 3 to 4 rotis, you know, in the table. Imagine if 4 people, 4 rotis each. You know, that roti alone is costing you 125 rupees. Now, this is what we call as a funnel. Now, what's a funnel? Funnel is what we call as an upscale, you know, upsells and downsells. When you go to a McDonald's, McDonald's doesn't make any money in the burger. Technically, a restaurant doesn't make much of money in the bhaji, though he makes though, right? But it's not the maximum profitable thing for him. The most profitable thing for him is, you know, like somebody said, drinks, yes, drinks, papad, and sides are the maximum profitable thing for them. Because maximum people order that, and the best part is they don't share that, which is why the cost doesn't get divided among the 4 people. So when you go to a McDonald's, what they do is, when you order for a burger, they won't just tell you, okay, take a burger. They'll tell you, sir, do you want to upgrade to a combo meal? Correct. So the thing is, when he is upselling you a fries and a Coke, that's where he's making maximum money. He's not making money in that burger. Burger is not money making thing for them, right? And that's what we call as upsells. Now tell me something: is it easy to go to a new customer, or easy to sell it to an existing customer? Who is easy to sell? A new customer or existing customer? Existing, right? But what we normally always every single time hunt for a new customer, whereas it's existing customers that we forget because we take them for granted, right? Don't do that, right? This is what we call the funnel. So for example, if I'm a manufacturer of clothes, and if you come to me, and suppose I've got a ready-made thing, right? And if you come to me, and if I tell you, I sell you a shirt, a smart salesman will tell you, sir, if you're buying shirts, why don't you have a pant as well? If you're buying a pant, why don't you have a handkerchief as well? Don't you want some ties? Don't you want some suits? He will keep on upselling you, correct? Till the time you say this is enough, right? But sometimes not everybody buys. So what they do is they say, sir, do you want to buy a shorts? Do you want to buy a handkerchief? At least take something and go, at least experience it. You see, in luxury industry, a Louis Vuitton or a Gucci or a Ferrari, They also sell you keychains. The keychain is also 5,000 rupees, but what is the, why the hell would sell a keychain to you? Because keychain is an aspirational value product. And that's what we call the downsell. You know, where I want you to buy something from me. Because once you buy something, you become my customer. When you become my customer, you notice my quality and my product, you will automatically buy something or other from me every now and then. And that exactly, okay, my friends, is what we call as downsells and upsells. So you should be creating a funnel for yourself, because you cannot make maximum money by just selling to new customers every single time. You can only make maximum money by selling to an existing customer and selling to a new customers, both simultaneously, right? So what the funnel is? Funnel is very simple. It's first of all, attract people by the three S's: social media, searches, and shopping. Shopping means you list your product on Amazon, Cartrate, Carvalho, depending on your industry. Right? What you do is you basically call them to a website. Now, when you come to a website, you should always get them to fill up a form. Now, there are two things that will happen. Either he'll fill up a form or he won't. If he fills up the form, then you start following up with them and ultimately he buys the product. So you make money, or he doesn't buy a product. Let's take for example, not everybody comes and fills up the form on your site. So some people came, they saw your site, but didn't fill the form. You start remarketing them. You start going after them. You keep on hampering them till the time they buy or die. And then finally, what you do is, you normally show them remarketing campaigns. What are remarketing? I'm sure all of you must have seen this. You know, when you basically go to any particular website, like a Make My Trip or a Amazon or a Flipkart, you must have usually seen this, okay? That maximum of you, you must have seen, you know, the same ad starts following you everywhere. Has it happened to all of you? Where same ad starts following you everywhere, wherever you go, once you go to one particular site, that's called remarketing or retargeting. So what you're doing is we're reaching out to existing customers. And once you do that, you remarket them, you get them, you again get them back to your site, and this time hopefully they'll fill up the form. And what if the person does not buy? If it does not buy, you still remarket them. And this is what we call as a funnel. A funnel is nothing but it is a process which you make to reach out to the customers again and again in an automation mode. That's what you should be doing. The third thing you should be doing is creating a funnel. And we normally also create a funnel, so whenever somebody comes to us, we keep on marketing them, we keep on showing them our campaigns. And that's how, you know, we kind of always reach out to these people. The last thing, okay, over here is what we call is, you know, using growth tools. So I'm going to show you two tools which are going to change your life. Now, for how many of you people currently over here, you know, hunting people's email address is one of the most priority things that you normally do. I mean, you know, you want your prospective customers' email IDs, and you face a very tough time in finding them through the internet. Give me a quick eye on the chat box. And you think if you get an email ID, you can do wonders with this. You can actually, you know, reach out to these people. Yep. So I'm going to show you a tool right now, which is exactly going to do that, which is exactly going to help you to find anybody's email address. But it's only for a company. It's only for a corporate. It's not for a, you know, it is not basically for, you know, small business, unfortunately. So let's take for instance that I'm looking for an email address for somebody from Larsen & Toubro, right? And I will reach out to these people. So I go to larsenandtoubro.com and I go to a website called hunter.io. This is a website called hunter.io, which we're going to use today to find people's email address. So you go to hunter.io, you go to lnt.com, you just simply copy this, you come back over here and you paste this over here, press enter, find email addresses. Now, once you find email addresses of people, look what happens. Okay. Just give me a moment. So what this tool does is, it gives me an email ID pattern of anybody from any corporate. So if you see, every corporate has a typical email ID. For example, if I have to find Anil Manansar's email ID, okay, from SPGen, there'll be a pattern called parimal.merchant@spgen.org or anil.menon@spgen.org. There'll be a pattern to the email address. Same way, this tool detects pattern for us, and then we can send an email to anybody we want. For example, you can see over here, the pattern for Larsen & Toubro is first.larsen@larsenandtoubro.com. Now look at this. Now suppose I go to LinkedIn and I want to find, you know, an employee's email address which I don't have currently. So I go over here And I'm going to try and find, say, for example, somebody from the MEB division, medium engineering projects division of Larsen and Toubro. And I'm going to find the name currently. Once I find the name, I'm going to put that name on this tool and I'm going to get their email addresses like this. So like this, we can basically do this for any corporate. You just put the corporate's, email address over there, and that's it. It can basically give you a lot of things. So let's take, for example, like go to the search bar over here. I type over here something like, let's take MEP head, okay, from L&T. Let me just type L&T, Larsen and Toubro. Because they're called Anirudh Bapat, right? I'll just take his name. I'll copy this name. I come over here. I just search this name over here. Press enter. Sorry. Press enter. And look at this. This tool will give me the email address of Anirudh Bapat. Anirudh.Bapat@larsenandtoubro.com. And the green means that, that it is, they're very confident that this is his most probable email ID currently for this particular employee right now. Likewise, okay, I can find email address of anybody I want. So let's take if I want to find email address of, somebody from spgen.org. I can do that. Okay, I can just type over here spgen.org, and let's take for example, I want to find email address of Sabina ma'am, so just Sabina Khan, I press enter. And anyway, sabina.khan@spgen.org is verified because her email is also shown in three websites currently on the internet. Correct. That's how I can find anybody I want. How many of you over here found this to be super amazing? You think that this is going to be life-changing for all of you? Where it'll basically open up doors for you if you're reaching out to corporates. Correct. So you go to corporate, type the name on on LinkedIn, and you figure out their email addresses, no matter wherever they are. Correct. So we can do that from here. So this is what we call is Hunter.io, right? It's one such tool which can help you do that. Okay, second tool which is going to be extremely easy for you is this tool called Scrap, Scrapp.io. You can see over here, Scrapp.io. Now, LinkedIn has a search capability, right, where I can search for anything I want. So let's take, for example, I'm looking for L&D heads, right, learning and development people. Okay, so for example, I can just type over here, people, and it's going to give me all the people currently, who are in L&D learning and development over here. So let's take all the people out here right now with me, and I want to reach out to these people currently. I want to go to them, reach out to them. So I can just there's a Chrome extension with scrap.io. So you go to scrapp.io. Go to scrap.io, and scrap.io typically can help you to if you just log in with your email address over here, log in with your LinkedIn ID. So what typically happens is, they can essentially help you, right, to scrap email addresses even if they are friends or they're not your friends on LinkedIn. So you can see currently when I go to this platform, okay, I don't know why not allowing me to log in. I forgot my ID pass, but I'm just going to show you what this tool does. Okay, if you install a Chrome extension, once you do that, you just click on Export Email Finder. Okay, then I have to log in with my email address. Once I log in, once I do that, okay, they're going to basically help me to figure out the email addresses of all the people currently. And the best part is absolutely free. You don't have to pay a single rupee to be over here. It's absolutely free, and but there's some limitations to number of searches every month that you give. I think 50 searches per month is free. Beyond free, they charge you, correct? So let's say 150 email credits I give you for free. So I come over here, okay. I kind of say launch the email finder, okay, and then basically I'll say okay, my target list is. So let me just export the email finder, okay. And I can say launch the email finder. Okay. Actually, from scrap dashboard. Let me just put this leads over here. Let me just do from Chrome extension. It'll be easier for me. This is my Chrome extension. I normally use this. They give me all the people out here. Okay, and then I have to just click on export.
Let me just do it one more time. Find email and save. Now once I basically find their emails, okay, and it's gonna be coming all into my dashboard right now, and I can get their email addresses. Normally it looks something like this. Very similar to the snow.io as well. Snow, Scrap, they all do the same stuff. And you can see over here, you know, when I come to my dashboard right now, it's going to give me the email ID of people, you know, whom currently I'm searching for. You can see over here, Akshay, Ipshita. Okay, so she's from Forum India. She's from Blackberries. You know, he's from Neosoft, head of L&D. Then Seema Wagle from eClerks. Jayashree Geet from Future Generali. Vodafone Idea, National L&D for Retail Ops. This is the email address for them. The Outlook N Plus, as well as their, you know, their email address. And that's how it's done. Okay. So this is what you do. So some growth tools. So two tools, Hinto.io, Snow.io, which you can use for your outreach. Right. And this is the four things, my friend. This is the four things you should be doing for yourself. So first things first, you should be doing finding your audience, find out your target audience. Second is create a marketing plan for yourself. The next is use build a funnel. And last is use growth tools to do that. So if you do these four things, I guarantee life will change and do something on digital. So yeah, so I hope that you enjoyed this. And I'm happy to take any questions if you have. Any question answers, anything you want, I can do that.
First question, sir, is please give an insight on how a commodity business like steel can use digital marketing as a tool from Pratik Agarwal Beta.
Okay. So Pratik, you know, so we've done this in the past. We showed this company called Pollard Steel or Pollard Bars. So in fact, the same tool that I showed you today, right? You see, if you do SEO, number one, because that's going to be like, you know, number one priority for you. The second thing is you should be doing what we call is Google Ads, because Google Ads can again help you to get your more business, because people search, right? Steel prices today, TMT bars, steel bars, right? And the third thing is you can use a growth tools like I showed you, you know, pitch to corporates, send an email, pitch to corporates and get your leads from there.
There is a question from Abhishek. It's not a question about his business, but he's just asking. He's
against privacy. Yeah, right. I read that.
He's Ajay sir's son, so he will ask these questions.
Right.
Okay. This is not against privacy.
So see, typically what happens is, you know, anything that you do on digital, you're individually losing your privacy. Because if you see, I can target you with Facebook. So the individual privacy is gone then and there itself. Now, they're not illegal tools. Why? Because they're just guessing the email address. They're giving the exact email address. And they're only extracting email IDs if it is there in the public forum. Correct. For example, Sabina Miss's email ID was there in the public forum, which is why they were able to give us a source of that email ID as well. Correct. So what these tools are doing is they're aggregating data from the web and they're giving it to you. Or they're guessing the email ID's pattern with your company. For example, if you see my pattern is firstname@mycompany.com. It's a pattern, right? And every corporate has a pattern. So it is a smart, which we normally call this growth hacks. So they're growth hacking tools which are guessing and they're helping you to find the right customers. But yes, you can find, as I told you, can find the email ID of a, you can find my personal email address over there. Why? It's not in public domain. So which is where you can't find that. So no, so they're not violating any privacy laws over here by giving you data which is already in public domain. That's how it's showing.
Superb.
Okay.
Superb. Nisha Bete, I got you now. And so Nisha, sir, this is a wonderful question from Ms. Elma Joseph. I think that's your guest, sir. So welcome, because first time I'm meeting the colleague. What strategy should we adopt to reduce the cost per lead in real estate? Hitesh sir?
Okay. So see, I mean, the simple answer to that, Alma, is that you have to do what we call A-B testing, right? So see, if you notice, when you saw my dashboard over there, I was just not running one campaign. I was running multiple campaigns. Now, why do I do that? To be very frank, no digital marketer in the world can guess, you know, whether your campaigns will do well or not. Yes, with experience, probably we can give you guidance, but nobody can tell you with surety that this will work or not. It's exactly like a print newspaper. When you basically put a creative in the print newspaper can't guarantee you saying that, okay, you know, like you'll get so many calls. Same way in digital. But what we normally do is, you know, unlike print, which is expensive, digital, we can do testing. So what we normally do is we put 200 rupees on two campaigns and we run both the campaigns simultaneously. For example, in one thing, I'll change the headline. Second one, I'll change the creative. And I'll test which one is working better, which is a campaign my audience is clicking more. So depending on where they click more and where, and what the results I get, you know, I will basically try to work on that campaign more and I put more money on that and I stop the one that's not working for me. So the simple answer to that is you should be doing what we call A-B testing if you reduce your cost per lead for yourself right now.
Fantastic. Sir, again, Ms. Elma Joseph is asking, what should be an ideal cost per lead in real estate?
It's very vague, Elma. You know, like, as I told you, we can guarantee you. So if it's affordable housing, it can go as low as 100 rupees. But with luxury, it will go to 1,000, 2,000 rupees per lead as well.
Sir, Avinash is asking a question. What are the charges for LinkedIn ad campaign? I want to connect in professionals in a particular domain.
See, LinkedIn ad campaigns, so see, digital world is not like your traditional marketing, you know, where people charge you, you know, like a fixed fee. It normally works on demand supply. So just to give an analogy, let's say today is Valentine's Day and you're a cake manufacturer, you know, and a lot of cake manufacturers are targeting people who are in a relationship. Will your ad cost go up on Valentine's Day or will it go down on Valentine's Day? It will definitely go up, right? Because a lot of people currently running the ad, trying to reach out to the same set of people. That's how digital works. If there are more people targeting same profession that you're doing, your ad cost will be high. And normally in digital, they charge you on the basis of CPM. We normally call this cost per thousand impressions. That means they charge you when somebody sees your ad, not when somebody clicks, not when somebody does anything. LinkedIn and Facebook specifically, they charge you on CPM basis. So the more you reach out to people, the more expensive the ad will become. So you have to reach out to relevant people in that case. So usually the lead cost on LinkedIn comes to between 1,500 rupees per lead. LinkedIn is expensive medium. So your product also has to be extremely profitable. If you're having a product with low margin, I wouldn't recommend running LinkedIn ads. But if you've got a good margin, then probably you can run LinkedIn ads in that case.
It's a wonderful question from Mehul ji. If I'm not wrong, our student from SVJ. How can this be used for rural synthetic sarees? Rural.
If you're doing rural marketing, okay, what I would just say is in rural marketing specifically. Okay, just one second.
I would request Anilji, since Anilji, the head of marketing of Damodar, is here. Sir also should please ask some questions. Anil, yeah. Biyani, sir.
So basically, I was just saying that if you're doing rural marketing, you have to do what we call as a lot of content marketing and influencer marketing in that case. That means you have to find somebody who's a voice in that industry, a voice in the local market, try to, you know, tie up with them, probably, you know, do a barter with them, give you a sarees for exchange of their promoting your sarees. So we normally call them influencer marketing. So you should do a lot of influencer marketing in that case, because that definitely can help you to reach out to more people that way. So rural marketing, influencer works pretty well. You know, your dealer models, okay, work pretty well over there. Digital, if you really ask me, until TikTok was there, should work pretty well, but even Facebook will do pretty well for you. So try running Facebook ads in rural markets maybe, because people definitely using Facebook over there also. So do that and tap into these groups, Facebook groups and all, which is going to help you to, you know, like, do things pretty well. So the three things you should be doing for yourself.
Influencer marketing, Mehul Bete. So just two comments. Nisha Bete, I got you. I remember you now. It is about AI. And Gani has answered Abhishek Ji's question. They're saying that these are information provided by oneself on public domain. So there's no violation of private privacy policy. Mehul Bete has thanked you, sir. Yes, thanked you. Sir, one more question which has come up here. This is from Dear Advait. From Cochin, if my small startup uses more keywords respecting the 1.1 ratio than a well-established company, whose valuation is many times more than mine, would the search engine still show mine at first?
Very good question, Advait. So see, today search engines are not biased. I mean, they give a chance to everybody, no matter you're a small company or big company. See, it's not just about putting keywords on a homepage. As it is, it's much, much more to that. For example, it's also about writing blogs. So let's take, for example, I don't know what business you are in, but let's take, for example, I'll take an example of same thing, PVC sheets. Let's take a business of PVC sheets, correct? Then if you keep on writing blogs, if you keep on writing articles, see, because Google loves people who write a lot of content. If you're able to write a lot of content for your, you know, and giving a lot of value to your audience through your website, then definitely you will get a lot of people coming to your site currently and, you know, and you start ranking on top. But whatever articles you write,
it also has to contain similar keyword what you're writing right now. So you might not be coming for the exact same keyword, but try for a bit broader keyword. For example, you might not be ranking for this keyword called PVC sheets, but you'll be ranking for this word called PVC sheet manufacturer in Nasik, right? So try to find longer words whom you think people search, but there's so much competition on that. So try to rank for those keywords first. Then once you get better at it, then try going for a shorter keyword.
So we continue the question from Nishaji. Rishabhatta is asking you, sir, Iteshi, if you would like to share any professional and reliable email marketing firms.
See, I personally use GetResponse for my email marketing. So I think that's pretty good. And, okay, I basically also do that.
Iteshi, sir, yeah. Put in the chat. Yeah.
I'll type it in chat box. Yeah, it's called GetResponse. 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 That's a very good email. It's quite affordable also. You know, it is not that expensive.
So one more question. Harsh Guptaji is asking, as ad campaign on Google gets older, the keywords get costlier. How to keep that cost low? Also, generic keywords does not give desired results. How to overcome?
So you can't have generic keywords. So it's Google ads is like a science in its own, to be very frank. A lot of these keyword types called broad match type and exact match type, just read about them, you know, because that will help you to reduce your cost, number one. And number two, there's something called negative keywords. For example, if you find somebody writing, say, steal jobs in India or something, then put words as jobs as negative. Because if you do not keep a tab on negative keywords, then, you know, it won't really help you to rank. And plus, you'll be ranking on irrelevant terms. Also, there's something called a search term report which you get from Google. So check your search term reports and see, you know, what exactly are people writing in the search term reports and what people are actually typing on Google and how they come into your site. And you can also check your analytics to get some more, you know, to cross-relate data from there. So look at data on Google Analytics, look at search term reports, find the keywords that are not relevant to you, put them in negative. What is relevant, you start bidding on them. That will help you to reduce cost. But if you just keep the same keyword list throughout, then obviously Google will start giving you junk results because you're not optimizing your keywords. To optimize your keywords, that's the key thing over there.
Sir, I was always, I'm sorry, I'm very curious now that there are no questions. How come you transform yourself so very well? Because last 10 years you've been doing this.
Right.
I'm sorry, I'm very inquisitive, but it's a personal question.
Yeah, it's okay. Yeah, no, so see, basically, I mean, you know, what intrigued me in marketing especially is that, you know, see, when I started doing digital, there were very few people who was doing digital long ago, right? Now it's a very cluttered market. Now every single second person is a digital marketing guy, to be very frank. But what really helped me, okay, in standing out from everybody else is, see, people ultimately go for a specialty in the market. I mean, they either become social media guys, or they become SEO guys, or they become SEM guys. But one thing that's transformed my life is learning. You know, I've been learning throughout. Like even today, you know, though in the lockdown, though I know so much, but I keep on still listening to a lot of courses of my competition, you know, of basically what's happening in the market, looking at a lot of YouTube videos. And, that keeps me up the game. So typically what happens is there are people who are only digital marketeers. And there are a set of people who are only traditional marketeers. There are a set of people only PR guys. But there's no competition called all three combined. So there's nobody PR, digital, and traditional marketer combined. And that completes me, you know, because I've been traditional marketing first. I did PR in the middle of the career. And then I completed as a digital. Plus, before that, I was a finance guy. I used to be working in a bank long, long back, right? So my finance knowledge helps me to look at numbers, look at data, look at analytics better, because I'm more objective when I see lead costs and all. So it keeps me in check. So what I believe is no knowledge goes waste, no matter whichever industry you belong to. You know, no knowledge goes waste. Whether you know economics, whether you know psychology, whether you know digital, you know, every single thing plays a very important role at the end of the day. Like, for example, you know, in between, I also learn about psychology. Psychology helps me to understand what people think, what people might ask me. And you preempt those answers in your text or in your, you know, in your training program or in your ads, for that matter, to reach out to these people. If you look at the framework of CDSPP, it's a psychological based framework. You see, people always want to address their problems. Nobody wants to get sold, right? So I believe no knowledge goes waste. You know, if you have a background in any industry, you can definitely pick up digital, because digital is all about understanding people, understanding what's in their mind, and then giving them the right solution at the end of the day. See, your product is the most important thing. Without a good product, without a good service, no matter how much your marketing we do, it won't really help us. For example, if I do great marketing and my product sucks, you know, nobody's going to come to me again and again. You know, I might be just one time, two time, I might sell to them, but third time nobody's going to come to me. So first thing, I think anybody should work with on their product. Then after they've worked on the product, then you start marketing a particular product and you start reaching out to more people. And you know, I just want to tell everybody over here that, you know, a lot of us also feel shy of sales. Like currently, you know, my passion right now is sales, because I think sales is the most important thing in this particular planet. Without selling, you can't do anything about it, right? You shouldn't shy from sales. Somebody else will sell your product and somebody else will sell their product and services to that particular customer. If their product sucks, and if your customer falls to them and doesn't come to you, that's your mistake. You know, because you're not able to sell them, you're not able to close them ultimately, correct? So it's your duty to sell him if you got a right product which is solving this problem. If you don't sell them, you're not helping your customer. Somebody else is doing that and he's taking your customers away, right? So don't shy from sales, you know. It is absolutely okay to sell, because ultimately that's what's running everybody's business, right? So yeah, I mean, you know, so currently for me, you know, I'm just intrigued with how this world moves very fast. And the reason I teach, because teaching, you know, helps me to keep me on top of my game. If I don't teach, I will not upgrade myself, because you know, the other people 10 times more smarter than what I am. So, you know, by answering people's question or by listening to them, I also kind of, it helps me to upgrade myself. So that's how transition happened.
Fantastic, sir. Fantastic. I'm sorry, sir, but one of the things before I take Anilji's question, sir, one of the things why I'm selfish to conduct these sessions is to introduce professionals like you. And now Kutsi Chaitanya has already put absolutely amazing session. Sir, how do you work as a professional on a retailership basis or on a project basis? You don't need to give numbers, but at least a business model, sir, please.
Yeah. So see, essentially what we do is we have two models that we work. So we have two major businesses. So our consulting business is called Skillopedia. So Skillopedia is a consulting arm. We consult companies. We help them build a digital framework. See, unlike agencies, we don't execute projects. We only do lead generation. That's a specialty. We can generate leads for any business. And typically what happens is we work in a retainer model with any client. So we charge them a particular amount for a particular month, right? And we take a minimum buy-in for 3 months, at least to start off the project with. Because first one goes in experimentation and understanding business. Second and third one, when the result starts coming in, right? So we do retainerships with clients. Especially we would like to have 1 year retainership, but now we have changed the model a bit. We say, okay, you know what, first you try for 3 months. If you like our services, then you go ahead. If you don't like it, we stop the services over then and there itself. Right. And we don't take up every business. Like, you know, for example, I will not take up a business which I don't understand. See, because digital is not about just digital marketing. At the end of the day, any marketing is about understanding the opposite person's business. So let's take, for example, like I don't believe in gems and jewelry. I know I don't believe in astrology, because, you know, I personally do not understand the business pretty well. So I would not take up that client if I don't understand that client. Right. So we're also very picky and choosy in terms of picking our clients, because, you know, if you don't understand it, we will not be able to market the product. We don't market the product, he will not get results on it. As simple as that. So you normally pick up the customer whom we think that we understand and who, you know, who matches our wavelength. Second thing is, yes, we do project basis. Also, project basis is very short. For example, making websites for people, or, you know, making landing pages, or let's take, for example, giving consulting to them. So sometimes people just come for one-time consulting, two-time consulting. So we also do that as well. You know, where we understand the current processes, we normally give them a solution, we give them a paperwork saying that, okay, this is what you should be doing. And then they take that paperwork back to their agencies or to their companies and they get things done, right? So yeah, this is the two model that we operate in. And our second business is training, which is called Nordstrom Academy, where we kind of help companies, we help professionals to train on digital. That's what we basically do. And yeah, so these are two models that we have.
If I'm not wrong, Hiteshi, you do conduct a lot of free webinars also.
Yes, yes,
how
yes.
How do these colleagues get in touch with you? Because you have given your contact details.
Yeah. So I'll leave my contact details. The best thing is just drop me a WhatsApp. I'll add it to one of the WhatsApp groups that we have. All right. And from there, you'll be able to get all the details. So I put my number on the chat box over here. And, you know, they can be updated through that.
So colleagues, I'm very clear. Idea was to introduce professionals to you. And I'm not hiding that fact. Here is the WhatsApp number for those who want to get connected to Hiteshji. Please do so directly. And here comes Anil sir's question. And I've gone to this place, sir, Calves and Leaves. Our family as a CSR is working on saving, serving and sustaining the Indian breed of cows. Have a lot of superbly beneficial products, which I completely agree. I have myself, have really, really, wonderful products that they have. The question that Anilji is asking is how to reach the masses, because we do not have a large budget. How do I find someone who would like to serve the cause and can handle the digital marketing with returns linked to sales on these products? So I think, let me repeat. It is Calves and Leaves. I've gone there about 200 plus Indian breed, and lovely products. Right. And they have some patents also. It's from the Damodar Industries Group. So they are looking for somebody who can help them, right? Vastu Floor, all coming in. See, Vastu Floor.
Got it. Soap, shampoo, okay, got it. Cool. So see, essentially, if you have such a wide range of products, first of all, you have to identify what's the star product. See, when you sell too many things, what's going to happen is people are going to get confused. I mean, you know, they wouldn't know what to buy, what not to buy. So what I believe is, for you, the process would be the first to get your branding right. Because branding is the key for a product like yours. When I say branding, it means that, for example, it's Patanjali. Why did Patanjali become famous? Because there is this thing called Swadeshi. The first one to come up with this Swadeshi thing, and you know, and they kind of harped on it very, very highly. Correct? Same logic. The first thing is get a good branding tagline for yourself, which is going to be consistent throughout your products and services across. Maybe a soap floor, you know, maybe it's Dhoop, maybe it's nasal drop, maybe whatever it is. Right? First thing. Second thing, I'm not sure if you've got a website or not. Second thing is basically, you know, get a landing page. Get like a one page, you know, like a web page which is going to list on all your products. And third thing is try to then drive traffic and get inquiries on that page, you know. So by traffic, I mean, see, I'm not sure, you know, what is the margin on your products. One thing I'll be very clear on, if you're using digital, you need to have some good amount of margins for your product as well, because anything with thin margins, you will end up losing money on digital. But, you know, there are two ways to look at it. For example, some people are absolutely okay burning money because they believe in what we call as long-term value. So in the sense that, suppose, once I buy a product from you and I like it so much, I'll at least buy 3 to 4 times in the next 1 year. So basically, I become an existing customer. And so you wouldn't like calculate the ROI basis just first sale. You will assume that if a customer comes, at least 4 sales is going to happen in the 1 full year. And then you're going to make X amount of margin. So whatever is your margin, take 20% of that particular margin, profit margin, and put in marketing. So for you, I would recommend do Instagram, do Facebook. These are the two best platforms for you. And try to market on those platforms where you're the strongest. You've got good distributors, you've got good sellers who are currently, you know, helping you to do that. And then you can start marketing to these particular products and services. That will basically help you to, you know, reach out to more people. And then try to build SEO, but SEO is a long-term game. SEO doesn't happen overnight. It takes minimum 6 months to 1 year to do a search engine optimization. So you have to devote 6 months to 1 year dedicatedly and try to rank for these terms like Dhoop, you know, say for example, you know, organic soap, organic market, to work on a single organic, because that's what I believe you do, right? And you can essentially start doing that. And then also try to take help of marketplaces like Amazon and all. Today you'll be surprised, but even Amazon sells Gobar, okay? So if you just type cow dung and all on Amazon, you know, you will find that cow dung is getting sold for 100 rupees. And, you know, and I'm not kidding. I'm extremely serious about it. For example, I'll just show this to you, okay, just to prove you. If you type over here, cow dung, okay, so try to find resellers for your product. You see over here, 165, 20 rupees, 169 rupees, 89 rupees, 249 rupees. Cow dung is basically getting sold on Amazon and stuff. So you should try it out. You know, you never know, it might just work for you.
So there's one more question which has come here. A truly eye-opener. Thank you, Piyushji. Right. How will digital marketing work? Where industries, electronic instruments, measuring instruments and product offered to them is very specific electronic components, then what do we do?
So essentially, who's the TG? Is it a purchase manager? Is it something else? Like, first of all, figure out who the TG is, right? And then you use Hunter.io to reach out to these corporates, purchase managers, maintenance managers who'd want your electronic weighing machine and all. That's number one. Number two is use LinkedIn. If you've got good margins, if you're majorly into B2B and you sell, you know, you sell like heavy equipment to them, then use LinkedIn marketing. That's better for you. And then you can also use the old-fashioned organic way where you get a sales team. You you get them to use LinkedIn Premium, and they kind of, you know, reach out to these people through LinkedIn, and they kind of send an email, send a message, follow up with them online, and try to get contact details for them.
Ashish ji, now as I said, the final comments are coming in. Today's session was a most explanatory. Now this can get controversial, so I'll just keep quiet. Right. By the way, Ashish ji, some sessions I had also taken. So this word most is, but you are good, sir. You are good, absolutely good. Especially certain things I noted down. I don't understand this much, but I keep learning something. So I like this entire thing about email hunter, right? I'll now talk to my son. He knows this better. Email marketing. Then that kid Nishaji's question, that was very, very good. Get right, which you mentioned. What was that, sir?
Get response.
Get response for email marketing. Thank you very much, sir. That point is very well taken. There's nothing known as B2B or B2C. It's about H to H. Mujhe ek dialogue mil gaya abhi, sir. Now I'm going to use wherever I can. Yes. And then, of course, I'm going to tell AI digital marketing guru se. Thank you, all of you all. God bless. Please get in touch with sir directly. Humble request. I would say one for his sessions, training sessions. I'm personally advocating. My son has done a course under sir. I have done a course under sir. Then I asked my son to join. So he has this amazing knack of teaching. He took a free session for all the teachers here and they simply loved it. What did he use, sir? Something.
So I use this engagement tool like Kahoot, Mentimeter and all to kind of, you know, engage the crowd when you're doing an online session.
So that has gone off very, very well, sir. Amazing feedback from the teachers here. And Advait is closing down by saying, amazing session, sir. Loved it. Right. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir.
So thank you so much, Anil, sir. You know, it's really a pleasure to always, you know, be with you and, you know, address this huge community of entrepreneurs. So thank you once again for having me over here. It's really a pleasure to interact with all of you.
Good night. Good night, all of you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.